Good afternoon, everyone. Welcome to the class on statistics. And this is our second class on statistics. In the first class, we basically discussed about what statistics is all about. So we talked about what was the history of the subject statistics. I hope you are pretty clear with the history of the subject statistics, how this subject came into the picture. So probably when we look into our history and if we try to understand who and when have started this subject. So as such, there's no statistical description about that part, that when the subject started and how the subject started. So from the ancient time, when we talk about societal development, humans started collecting data. So maybe the data would be collected with using different symbols, signs. Maybe that time numerical values were not there, but data collection was always there. So the initial reason of using this data to find out probably how many people are living in the society, and with that probably in the society, the calculation of taxation or the calculation of military organization could have been framed. So when we look into the subject statistics, the relevance of the subject you can find from the Latin word called status, or German word called statistic, or French word called statistique, or Italian word called statista, where all these words means political state, where the subject was mainly associated with the administrative affair of the state, means how a state can be administered. So the tool for administering, those who are educated, like we had someone called Chanakya, who was the economist during the time of Chandragupta Maurya. He guided Chandragupta Maurya how he can fight against his competitors and how he can become such a great ruler. So the relevance of the subject was always there. And whoever king could able to implement that, they become a very famous king. So when we look into the subject statistics, if we try to understand the subject statistics, probably the limitation of the subject statistics is that whenever we work on statistics, statistics can only work on numerical value. Statistics can only work on such form of data which can be numerically expressed. Some form of data which are not numerically expressed, it would be very difficult to work on any form of analysis on them. Nowadays in statistics, we study a chapter called theory of attributes. So while working on theory of attributes, we have actually limited this limitation where we could able to convert the qualitative data into quantitative form, and then we can easily work on the possible research mechanism on which we want to engage ourselves. So while working on the subject statistics, to understand the scope of this subject statistics, in order to work on this subject statistics, probably the unit on which the subject is based on, the subject is based on something which is very discrete, which we call as data. The data can be of two types. Data can be either, it can be either quantitative data. When we say the data, it can be either quantitative data or it can be either qualitative data. So when we say quantitative data, the another name of quantitative data is cardinal data. The other name of quantitative data is cardinal data, while the other name of qualitative data is ordinal data. So when we work on the subject statistics, we try to work on data. We will first thing what we do while working on this subject, the first thing we'll try to work on something called collection of data. We try to work on how we can collect the data. So statistics is all about the research. That research which we want to engage with an objective. So every time when you have an objective in your mind and you want to engage in some form of research, so what do you do? First thing, you try to figure out on what data source you need to do your research. So the first step is the collection of data. Talk about this collection of data. When we talk about this data can be collected by two ways. Either we can work on primary data or we can work on secondary data. So when we work on this data, we can either work on primary data or we can either work on secondary data. So already we have discussed about primary data and secondary data in the last class, but I realize that some form of confusion is there. So I just want to make sure that confusion should be cleared. So the first step while working on statistics is to collect data. So we'll do data collection, because without data collection, we cannot do any analysis. Okay. So when we try to collect the data, then the question arises, on what medium can we collect the data? So here two possible mechanism what we can work on. One is primary data, second is secondary data. Primary data are those data which we collect ourselves. Okay, so depending upon our objective, instead of relying on some data which is already available in public domain or social media platform or in Google, instead of relying on Google or social media or library or any published or unpublished domain for the data, if we collect the data by ourselves, depending upon our objective, then that form of doing research is all about working on primary data. And the individuals who work on primary data are called as enumerator. The enumerator are those individuals who work on the collection of primary data. And when we work on the collection of primary data collection, different methods we follow. What are those methods? We talked about those methods in past. One is called direct observation method. So we worked on direct observation method. So when we work on direct observation method, we probably follow a mechanism where whoever our test respondent will gather them together, and they are being monitored. Like when the coronavirus vaccine was being developed, then different volunteers were requested. They came, their blood, the urine samples were being collected before injection of vaccine. And then once the vaccine was injected, then again the body was being monitored over the period of the time. And then probably an output could have gathered. So this kind of technique is called direct observation method. Direct observation method applies much more relevant whenever we work on biological research, because biological research are much more sensitive in nature. Such form of research which are not that much sensitive, we can depend on something called mailed questionnaires. We can depend on something called mailed questionnaires. And by working on mailed questionnaires, we try to gather primary data from them. Okay, we send the questionnaires. Nowadays, we are living in the world of Google form. So any relevant information, wherever I'm working on, if the college want to gain from the student for attendance purpose, for any reason. So the very easy way is to work on is the mailed questionnaires. So what I can do for attendance also for today, what I can do, I can immediately go to Google form and I can create a Google form where I request you people to give your name, your roll number and probably any other details which would be relevant for me. And then I can take your attendance. So the moment you submit that, I'll get the attendance. So I don't have to spend my time taking attendance. So mailed questionnaires are much more relevant in the era of internet, where we can connect with each and everyone very easily in the time when probably social distancing is the norm. So mailed questionnaires have become much more relevant for any kind of research what we are going through. Only problem with these kind of technique is how much we can rely on these data, because we are not very much sure our respondent. What our respondent, what probably would be their basic understanding level about the kind of research what I'm going through. So because that is completely indirect form of communication, where anyone and everyone who can be the part of any medium through which I can connect them, I send questionnaires to them and I expect them to answer my questionnaires. So again, you need to be very clear with the validity and scrutiny of the data if you are following such kind of mechanism. So apart from direct observation method and mail questionnaires, you can work on interview method to collect the primary data. When we talk about interview method, you can have direct interview method, indirect interview method, you have telephonic interview method. So that also you can collect the primary data. So we have discussed about them in last class. You can spend more time going through them. Probably you'll understand this. And again,
you want the material for this, I'll send you this material. You can go through this material and you can understand what I'm talking about. I'm talking something which is very generic, nothing I'm talking about which is difficult. So mail questionnaires, direct interview method, indirect interview method. When we talk about direct interview method, we talked about direct observation, tag interview. We can directly connect with our respondent, trying to gain information from them. But again, it's time consuming. It requires a lot of money. Okay, probably it may make more sense if we work on limited data. So then direct interview method would have made more sense. Indirect interview and all will become more sense when our respondent are victim of some kind of scenario, maybe accident or maybe any natural calamities or anything like that. So instead of connecting them directly, we can connect the people who were the part of the event, maybe directly or indirectly. So from them we can gain understanding about how that event would have happened and how we can narrate that event. So that we talk in the term of indirect interview. So apart from indirect interview, when we talk about, we have telephonic interview. So telephonic interview, again, you know that in the present era of Corona and all, probably direct or indirect interviews are getting more and more difficult. So the options limited with us is probably these forms of communication. Either they are mail questionnaires or either they can be telephonic interview. So I hope you have understood about them, the basic understanding about primary data, secondary data and all. Okay, so now you understood what was primary data. Talking about secondary data. Secondary data are such form of data which is already available. So such form of data which is already available. And if we try to gather those data, okay, if we instead of simply, 1 minute. So secondary data are those forms of data which is already available. So such forms of data which is already available. So if that data is already available, so if we simply get that data from some published or unpublished medium, and if we use the data depending upon our objective, then that form of working of data is called as secondary data. In the case of secondary data, we don't do hard work to gather the data in the form. When we are working on secondary data, we are more dependent. Guys, 1 minute. So I was talking about secondary data. Secondary data is the data which is already available in public domain, in social media platform, or maybe in Google or Wikipedia or in library, or in some project work, the data which is already available. If we simply use the data which is already available for our purpose, that way of using data is all about working on secondary data. So I hope you understood the difference between primary data and secondary data. What is the implication of working on primary data and secondary data? Basically, when we work on statistics, when we are working on statistics, In the case of statistics, we describe statistics as either it can be descriptive statistics or it can be either inferential statistics. So if we are trying to work on statistics, it can be either descriptive statistics or it can be either inferential statistics. Descriptive statistics is all about working on population. So what is population? Population is the sum total of all the entities which are the part of a research on which I want to do research. Then that is called population. Certain time when we do research, we cannot do research on each and every individual who are the part of our research. So instead of targeting each and everyone who are the part of my research, probably I can take a small sample of the population
and the kind of result what I get from a sample, from that I'll try to understand the complete population. That way of doing research is called inferential statistics. So different sampling techniques are there, stratified sampling, cluster sampling, multi-stage sampling, quota sampling, judgmental sampling, probability-based sampling. So you can study about different sampling techniques that was there in 11th, 12th statistics, that was there in UG also. Probably for in PG level, different forms of sampling techniques are not that much relevant. So I'm not gonna spend more time on them. If you want to understand, you can understand more about them. So here in inferential statistics, we work on sample. And the based upon the output, what we get from the sample, we try to understand the complete population, where we use the theory of interpolation and extrapolation. So different techniques are there of interpolation, extrapolation. Either they are Newton advancing differencing method, or either they are binomial expansion method. If you refer any PU or 11th, 12th or BCom, BBA books, you will get theory of interpolation, extrapolation techniques and all. In my YouTube channel also, I have made a lot of videos on interpolation and extrapolation. You can read about them, you can watch videos, understand what this is all about. So in inferential statistics, we talk about interpolation, extrapolation techniques to understand the complete population. The statistics is all about the research. The research what we are doing, in order to do that research, we need integral unit. For that research, the integral unit of research, what we are engaging ourselves, that is done on data. When we talk about data, data can be either qualitative data or data can be either quantitative data. It depends upon what form of mechanisms we are working on to work on data. So whenever we work on data, the first step what we do in statistics, the first step is to gather data. The first time what we do, we trying to gather the data. So if we gather the data, probably then only we can do anything. If we don't have data, we cannot do anything. So to gather the data, we follow different techniques to gather the data. Either we rely on primary data or either we rely on secondary data. The data what we gather, they are either quantitative data or they are either qualitative data. Qualitative data are those forms of data which are not in numbers, like they are in characters, alphabets, alphanumeric, like your gender data, of gender data, of religion, the data of nationality. Those are data are qualitative data. The other name of qualitative data is ordinal data. While when we talk about quantitative data, like when we are expressing the data in numerical values like marks, height, weight, those are quantitative data. So probably when we are working on statistics, while working on statistics, we cannot work on qualitative data. In order to work on statistics, our data should be numerically expressed in the quantitative form. Whenever we are working statistics, we cannot work on single data. We need huge data. More data we get, more better form of analysis we can do. More errors we can erase. So that is the limitation of the subject statistics. Statistics can be sometimes misused also. You have heard nowadays in social media platform, lot of evidences, lot of data are being put forward to prove or disprove anything. Nowadays, like new things are coming, like Kohli has just now retired from captaincy. So now people are putting data where they're proving that Kohli was not a good captain. So see, I'm not a fan of Kohli, neither I am against Kohli. So it's just like people are presenting false data or false representation to disprove or prove anything. So with looking at merge that form of data, we can come up with some form of conclusion that Kohli has never made RCB to win any IPL. Then Kohli was not a captain who won all different formats of ICC tournaments. So with that, if that data are presented, so it looked like Kohli was not a good captain. But again, I have a lot of other data which can prove that Kohli is the best captain. You're getting me? I can prove that Dhoni was the best captain of India of all time. So we can prove or disprove anything based upon, we just need data. We need data. If you put that data with that limitation of that data, we can come up with any kind of conclusion. So the good or bad thing about this data, the good about the data is that whenever we work on statistics, our research is limited to the certain forms of data on which we are working on. So in reality, the data are infinite. Okay, but we cannot work on infinite data at the same time. So while working on statistics, we will work on limited form of data. With those limited form of data, we can prove or disprove anything. So that's why the role of enumerator when it comes to primary data become much more relevant, because ultimately how knowledgeable is the enumerator who collect the primary data, based upon that, what form of data enumerator will collect, based upon that only we can come up with any form of conclusion. I hope you are getting this. Now, talking about the function of the statistics, what are the function of the subject statistics? It help us to simplify complexity of the data. So nowadays, as a social animal, we use the subject statistics in all disciplines, either it is biology or either it is physics or either it is science or either it's maths, either it's balance sheet, accountancy, anywhere, anything and everything. You remember ratio analysis we do in accountancy, liquidity ratio, leverage ratio, activity ratio, solvency ratio, all that, whatever ratios analysis we do, what actually we do? We're actually working on statistics. What is P&L, which talks about the accounting performance of the company in a given operating year? That is what? That is basically and statistics only. What balance sheet talks about? It talks about the financial position of the firm. So that is what? That is statistical description of the performance of the company in 1 year. What was the performance of the company? What is the total form of assets and liabilities? That is statistics only. So anything and everything what we use, we work on, either it is medicine or business management or either it's economics, anywhere and everywhere we work on statistics. If you go to the doctor, the first thing what doctor will tell you to do some test. Okay, and while doing that test, doctor will try to aggregate the facts. Doctor will try to bring lot of facts together. So when we work on statistics, in statistics, we work on collecting evidence. We work on collecting data. Once we get the data, in order to work on statistics, the data should be numerically expressed. Okay, and then probably once that data which is being collected, then probably what we do, we try to organize the data. So once the data we collected, what we try to do on the data, we'll talk about after the collection of data, we talk about organization and the classification of data. The next thing we talk about is the organization and the classification of the data. We talk about how we can organize and group the data into different parts. Here we form of different techniques. Either we can divide the data on the form of geographical classification. So we may follow geographical classification, or we follow temporal classification, or we follow temporal classification, or we follow chronological classification, or we follow chronological classification. Chronological spelling can be wrong, you can check the spelling. Okay, or we can follow geographical, temporal, the name temporal is chronological only. Then the third thing is quantitative classification, and the last one is qualitative classification. So these are the different forms. These are the different forms in which we can classify and group our data. So once the data is being collected, the first thing when we work on statistics is the collection of the data. Once the data is collected, then we cannot work on those huge data at the same time. Okay, so the first thing what we need to do, we need to organize the data into different groups. Okay, like I'll show you an example. So suppose for the project work, I do a lot of Excel analysis. So suppose for the project work, okay. I'm doing some research and I got some data.
Okay, I got some data here. So you can see around 6725, around 6725 patients I have. Okay, I got some data. Okay, so these data are probably different parts of India who all got corona. Okay, what was the age bracket? What was the gender? Which part of city, which part of Indian city they belong to it? Which state they belong to it? So I got some scenario. Okay, I got some data, a lot of data are there, you can see. Okay, so probably here, once I get this data, what I need to do? I need to classify this data. I need to group club the data together into different parts. So here what I did, I classified them into different part. I divided this data either on the basis of the city, either I divided them on the basis of the state what they belong to, either I divided them all up more or less on the basis of nationality or types of transmission. So what I can do, once I got this data, the best thing what we use for the classification analysis is what we do is basically we use pivot table. So if I use pivot table and if I see here, so probably what I can do, I can do some research. Like I got, okay, so how many patients I can find out, okay. So based upon the data, what I got, how many are male, how many are female, I can find the percentage of male and female. So how much more victim were male, how many were female, I can do that research. Okay, so around 49% were female. So how many would be male? So how many would be male? Male would be around 50%. Total 100%. You're getting it right. So what I can do, I can write them in percentage. So I did very simple. The moment I got this data, first thing I found out, okay, with this I can say that yeah, corona has impacted male more than female on an ideal basis. Okay, so if I remove that, once that part is done, that research is done. Okay, what else research can you do? Okay, so next thing, what can I do? So next thing, detected city, if I tick, so you can see, so which city, so you can see, you can find which state they belong to. Then after detected city, you can find the states also, or you can do research only on city. You can find the states also, which state. So you can have a better understanding. So here what I can do, I can put state here. If I put state here, I can see, okay. So Andaman and Nicobar Island. So if I say Andaman and Nicobar, so no patient was for Andaman and Nicobar, okay. Then remove Andaman, Nicobar. Andhra Pradesh, how many were there? So I can see, yeah. In Andhra Pradesh, these were the districts where I can see the people suffering. Guntur, like this. Are you getting it? I can find the percentage. So we can do all form of analysis. Okay, right now, the purpose of telling all this is that, so once we collected the data, the next thing what we need to do in statistics is the classification, organization of the data. So when we talk about classification and organization of the data, there we talked about how we can group the data into different parts. So we try to divide the data and similar forms of data, we try to bring them together. Okay, and then we try to focus more of our research. Then probably these divisions will make our analysis in much more better way. So you can divide the data either based on geography. You're getting, like here you saw the geography, right? In this research, corona data. So here I divided the data based upon the geography, means which part of India they belong. So probably next time when the government of India come up with the vaccine, so if I know that which states are worst affected, probably I can probably request government of India to first give vaccine to those states only which are impacted more than to the state which impacted less. You're getting it right.
So this way, if we do, this way, if we work on, probably we can do our research in much more better way. So that is the objective here. Here is to analyze the scenario when we are analyzing the scenario. Here we want to know probably what form of a research can make more sense. So what form of research can make more sense here? So that sense, how we can generate to do that sense, that sense can be generated once we start working on analysis. So before we work on analysis, we need to make sure that we can divide this data when what we have into different groups. Okay, so the groups can be here, like we have discussed about those groups. So those groups, we divided the corona data based on detected city or either on state basis, what is the status right now, that's hospitalized or recovered or they expired, whatever, which part of the world they belong. So a lot of data I had, and gradually what I was doing, I was trying to group this data into different parts. I can group this data based on geography. I can group this data based upon time period. So temporal classification also means chronological classification, where we can group the data based upon the time period. Then it can be quantitative classification. Quantitative classification is also called as cardinal classification, where you give emphasis to the numerical values. Okay, and those set of data which are there in the numerical form, we can arrange them in ascending order or descending order, increase order or decrease order, all that. Okay, so you can see this age bracket. This is a quantitative data. So I can do short, smallest to largest. So probably as per my data, what I have, the smallest age bracket people who got corona was 10 year old. And so my research is limited to that, this much data, where I can see that probably the people from 10 to 95 years were more impacted from the impact of corona. You're getting it right. So this age bracket will actually help me to understood probably what form of age bracket were impacted more from the corona than for the other form of age bracket. So quantitative classification, when we talk about organization, when I talk about, we'll group numerical data together, and then doing research on them would be much more easier. But qualitative classification is also not impossible to work on. So in order to work on qualitative classification, what we do, we apply theory of attributes techniques, and then we try to group the data together to form quantitative form of data. And those quantitative form of data would definitely help us to do our research in much more efficient way, so that limitation of statistics, where that limitation says that you cannot work on qualitative data, can be minimized. Clear, everyone? Anyone, any doubt, please ask me questions.
So we have discussed about basically in statistics is all about how we can work on data. Statistics is all about how we can convert the data into information. So the first thing while working on statistics is the collection of the data. Once the data is being collected, then the next thing what we talk about is the organization and classification of the data. While working on organization and classification, we talked about geographical classification, how we can group and ungroup data based upon geography. We talked about temporal classification, another name is chronological classification, on the basis of time period, because time period plays very significant role, right? Any events, if we try to bring a lot of events together, but we need to arrange them in chronological order. So because the event which has happened recently will impact us more than to the event which has happened much more earlier. So in temporal classification, we talk about this discussion where we talk about, on the basis of time period, how we can group the data. Quantitative classification is all about numerical form when we try to arrange the data. The qualitative classification is all about attributes. So the features or either it's based on gender or either it's based on religions or either it's based on nationality. If we get the data of such forms, how we can use them in our research, that is what we call as attributes. So quantitative data, the features of quantitative data is called as variable, while the feature of qualitative data is called as attributes. So while working on attributes, while working on how we can convert this qualitative form into quantitative form, ultimately we try to group the data on different parts. Once the grouping is done, we can use different forms of analysis. We can, next thing what we work on, once the grouping, once the classification, the next thing what we do is the we'll work on analysis on the classified data. So we next thing what we do, we'll talk about analysis on data. So in statistics, when we talk about statistics, first thing we talk about was the collection of the data. So we talked about how we can work on data, how we can collect the data. Next thing we talked about was the organization and the classification of data. Okay. And then the third thing what we talked about was the analysis on data. So when we talk about the analysis part, we need to analyze the data, because ultimately without analysis, you cannot come up with any kind of conclusion. So you collected the data, you grouped the data. Then the next thing what you need to do, you need to analyze the data. You need to follow different techniques of mathematics, different techniques of theoretical description of data based on normal distribution, binomial distribution, Poisson distribution, and then you need to work on the analysis part of the data. So normally while working on the analysis part of the data, when we work on the analysis part of the data, we follow how we can represent the data. So we can represent the data either through normal distribution, or we can represent the data through binomial distribution, or we can represent the data through binomial distribution, or we can represent the data through Poisson distribution. So when we look into the analysis part of the data, we can do analysis based on normal distribution, binomial distribution, and Poisson distribution. Binomial distribution and Poisson distribution are based on probability, while the normal distribution is based on continuous data form. Okay, so normally majority of the time when we discuss the questions and all, we'll discuss everything under normal distribution curve only. So normal distribution curve, this is a bell-shaped curve. So where we believe that if we allow the data to aggregate, we believe that the majority of the data will aggregate at the center. Okay, this is the formula of the probability calculation under your normal distribution curve. Okay, this is your probability calculation under the normal distribution curve, where we believe that if we allow certain set of data, continuous data, what we have, binomial and Poisson distributions are basically a discrete distribution pattern. So if we have a continuous data with us, if we allow this data to segregate among themselves, then we'll find that the majority of the data lies at the center. And this was first proposed under normal distribution curve. This is called as normal distribution curve. So this curve can have different deficiencies based on skewness and kurtosis that we'll discuss sometime later on. So when we talk about a normal distribution curve, so under the normal distribution curve, under the standard normal distribution curve, your mean, median, mode all lies at the center. Okay, under the standard normal distribution curve, they all will lie at the center when we talk about them. Then probably it's not like all the data will be at the center. There would be some data which would be deviated from the center, and that we measure through measure of dispersion and all.
So the measure of central tendency, measure dispersion are mainly the two terms which we'll discuss a lot under the normal distribution curve. So whenever we have a data with us, if we try to understand the nature of the data, we'll either try to understand that nature of the data either based on normal distribution or either based on binomial distribution or either they based on Poisson distribution. Binomial and Poisson are basically discrete distribution pattern which is based on probability. Normal distribution is mainly continuous distribution pattern. Okay, and in exam you'll get lot of questions on numerical or normal distribution, while binomial and Poisson the chances of coming in Bangalore city is very less. You get questions on binomial and Poisson in BTU university. So that is the scenario, but even then you need to have a basic knowledge about them. So when we study the chapter called probability or when we study theoretical distribution of data, there we'll spend a lot of time discussing about them. So I hope you understood what all we have done so far. We have discussed about collection of data. We talked about organization and classification of the data. We talked about analysis of the data. Anyone, any doubt, any question? Anyone, any question? So in the analysis part, we use a lot of techniques based on measure of central tendency, measure of dispersion, and we'll do a lot of calculation while working on analysis part. Ultimately, in analysis part, we'll do a lot of mathematical homework. And once that homework is done, we want to show to the world the homework, what we have done. So that comes, the next thing is how you can interpret from the data. Once your analysis is done, next thing what we talk about is the interpretation of the data. So based upon your analysis, what was your interpretation about the data? And whatever you interpreted from the data, whatever the interpretation is there on the data, based upon that interpretation, we'll talk about presentation of the data. Talk about how we can interpret whatever we interpreted. That is the homework what we have done from our end. But now rest of the world should know what form of interpretation is being done. So that interpretation is being shown to the world in the form of presentation of data. Different forms of presentation is given. Then it can be textual presentation, or it can be either tabular presentation, it can be either tabular presentation, okay, or it can be either diagrammatic presentation, or either it can be either diagrammatic presentation when we try to present the data, or it can be either diagrammatic and then it can be either graphical presentation. So different forms of presentation of data is there. Different forms of presentations of data is there. Textual presentation, tabular presentation. Tabular presentation is all about how you present the data in the form of table. Diagrammatic presentation, when we talk about diagrammatic presentation, we take the help of different diagrams like line diagram, bar diagram, pie chart. Line diagram can be simple line diagram, multiple line diagram, multiple bar diagram, or it can be subdivided bar diagram. So different forms are there. We'll talk about them in future. Graphical presentation of the data talks about frequency curve, frequency polygon, histogram, less than ogive, more than ogive. We'll talk about them. So basically, when we talk about presentation of the data, in the case of presentation of data, we're actually talking about the form of research, what we have done so far, how we can present to the world what we have done research on that. That is what presentation of data is all about. So in statistics, is all about the form of statistics, what we are studying here. In that form of statistics, we are talking about data. What is data is all about? We work on data. We try to collect the data. We organize and classify the data. Then we do analysis using different mathematic techniques. Once that analysis is done, then we talk about interpretation. Once that interpretation is done, we'll talk about presentation of the data. So this is what statistics is all about. So anyone, any question, anything you want to ask from me? So if I talk about presentation of data, what presentation of data is all about? Presentation of data is all about how you can present to the world the research what we have done. Statistics is all about research. We work on research. We do research based upon some objective was there in my mind. I was very interested to know that why people from Andhra Pradesh and Tamil Nadu, they are such a great engineers. Why students from Andhra Pradesh and Tamil Nadu, they become great engineers, they become great educated people. Why people in Andhra Pradesh and Tamil Nadu are so much educated? So for doing that research, what I am doing, I started collecting sample. So I went to different parts of Andhra Pradesh. I went to different parts of Tamil Nadu. I collected a lot of sample by using primary data. That was collection of data. Then what I did, I talked about organization and classification of data, where the data what I collected, I divided based upon different districts. Then I did analysis where I took the data, whatever I got, based upon that, I performed a lot of statistical technique. So we follow the techniques of measure of central tendency dispersion. So all mathematical work, what we have done, that was the analysis part. So once the analysis part is done, whatever I interpret from my analysis, I need to tell to the world. That telling to the world, we do in the form of different forms of presentation. Like yesterday, there was a match between India and Namibia, where India win the match, but India still could not able to go to the semi-final. So what I can do, I can talk about here the presentation, and that presentation I can do in the form of textual presentation. Textual presentation means I'll write a story, what all happened yesterday, everything, anything and everything I'll write. That was textual presentation, like what you get in newspaper. Then it can be tabular presentation in the form of table, scorecard. You get the scorecard, your work is done. That was tabular presentation. Then diagrammatic presentation. Many people are not that much educated. So for them, I can draw a diagram. So I can use histogram and all. So with that, people, by looking at diagram, people can easily understand what has happened. Then again, other way, I can use graph. Diagrams and graph more or less make same form of relevance. And ultimately, by that way, I'll present the research which was being done. Presentation is all about communicating to the rest of the world the form of research which is being undertaken. So I hope you have understood what all I have done for this class. Let me know if you have any doubt. Guys, please ask questions. This much from the today class.